Hi.
How are you? Nice to see you. Yes, I remember you.
You must try it sometime.
I'm going to.
Do you not use it? Don't they use it on the set ever with clothing problems? Maybe they do, and you're just not aware of it.
They probably wouldn't tell me. They're not supposed to have clothing problems.
Don't tell Michael. Yeah. Excuse me. Well, Michael, it's very nice to see you again.
Nice to see you.
And we talked during restoration, and you had great success with that movie. I'm happy for you.
Oh, thank you.
And this, of course, is an entirely different kind of movie, but so delightful.
I thoroughly
enjoyed it. Was it a good change of pace for you?
It was a really good change of pace for me to get to come back, travel back through the centuries, to the 20th century, travel back from London to what really was the story that I was interested in, because it seemed to reflect what went on in my own home. I mean, I'm not divorced, but the conflicts that Mel and Jack have between, you know, control and his being a little irresponsible, but and her being too controlling. I mean, we live through this all the time, and my wife and I have very different parenting styles, like the two of them have, and that generates a lot of conflict too. And also, you know, I really felt like I was very, very grateful when I read the movie. I was very, very grateful to my child, because I realized if I hadn't had a son, I wouldn't ever have done this movie. I never would have made it. I would never have seen what it was. And because I did feel very inspired by him, and I really wanted to make a movie where the parenting was sort of represented kind of very truthfully and very specifically and very carefully. And I think hopefully we did that, you know. Michelle and George have obviously both contributed tremendously to that, one way and another. George, in a way, as much through his not having been a parent as being a parent, and Michelle being kind of supermom.
The children, excuse me, my throat is in bad shape.
Do you want some water?
No, it's okay. The children are just fantastic in this film.
Yeah.
And they're very experienced little actors. But still in all, they are children. So what did you as a director do to try to get the very best performance out of them?
Well, you know, they're both very, very smart, you know, and I trusted that. And I mean, they were both absolutely capable of understanding these situations because they go through them. I mean, one of the most telling things, any screening I was ever at, I talked to 2 8-year-olds after they saw the movie. And what they said was, well, I said, what do you think the movie's about? Well, it's about these 2 kids who are trying to get through their day, and they have these things, they want to get to this soccer game, and their parents do this to them, and their parents do that to them, and their parents put a game to a daycare center instead of taking, they shouldn't do that, they should play with them. So, you know, there was a way of talking about the movie as a movie about the kids, you know, and they then understood it very, very clearly. So, and they're both technically very proficient. I mean, the only trouble I ever had with the kids was the day we shot the scene at Serendipity, because they're eating all this ice cream, and I thought, if they start eating all this sugar at 9 a.m, this is going to be over by 11, you know. And so we made these beautiful, like, ice cream confections with no sugar in them, gave them to the kids, and they just turned into, like, prima donnas. They were like, I'm not doing the scene. I can't do it. I can't do it this way. I'm not eating this. I can't do it with this. If there's not sugar in this, we're not doing it. And so finally, I mean, after we were down for about an hour trying to negotiate with the kids, I just said, well, you know, so bring on the sugar. And so... And they just got better and better, you know, and bigger and bigger. And they became like Carol Channing and Jim Carrey by the end of the afternoon. They were just huge and worked out fine.
Was George ever kind of at sea with the kids?
I think he got frustrated with the kids. I don't know if he's at sea. He's very playful, and the kids loved him for that. So, but... I mean, Michelle and I have a total of $11,000 in bets with George and have a child by the time he's 40. And he informed us yesterday that instead he decided that he'd have a vasectomy and pocket the other $6,000. You know, he said he figured he could do that for $5,000. He's not a lover of kids and animals. I mean, you notice when he's with that kitten and he's always sort of petting its head. I always sort of see this slight twisting motion, like he'd be just as happy to be doing some damage. May, who loved the kitten, was like always rushing up to grab it from George between takes to protect it. You know? So.
I felt, though, that May just really loved George. I mean, I think she does love him in real life.
She does love him. Last night we had the cast and crew screening, and George went along, which is like, you know, testament to the kind of guy he is. He's just such a, you know, he's such a good man. He's a great guy. And I said, I saw May's parents. I said, where's May? Oh, she's on George's lap. You know, there they were down, you know, the fourth row playing again.
Well,
she loves him.
Again, it's just a delightful film. It should do very well for all of you.
Thanks a lot.
And I look forward to the next time we visit. I don't
Great.
Know what it, what your project
I
is.
I don't know but yet either. But
I look forward to it.
Okay.
Thank you, Mike.
It's a pleasure. Oh, I'm glad you like. Oh, I could be talking about something mm-hmm. else that might help you. Yeah. No, I haven't decided yet. I might possibly do something else with Michelle, which we had a very, this was a very happy experience all the way around, you know. If I could just work with these people, the producer, this cast, for the rest of my life, I'd be perfectly content.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi. How are you? Nice to see you. Yes, I remember you. That's right.
You must try it sometime.
I'm going to.
Do you not use it? Don't they use it on the set ever with clothing problems? Maybe they do, and you're just not aware
of
it.
They probably wouldn't tell me. They're not supposed to have clothing problems.
Don't tell Michael.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Well, Michael, it's very nice to see you again.
Nice to see you.
And we talked during restoration, mm-hmm. and you had great success with that movie. I'm happy for you.
Oh, thank you.
And this, of course, is an entirely different kind of movie. But so delightful.
I thoroughly
enjoyed it. Was it a good change of pace for you?
It was a really good change of pace for me to get to come back, travel back through the centuries, to the 20th century, travel back from London to what really was the story that I was interested in because it seemed to reflect what went on in my own home. I mean, I'm not divorced, but the conflicts that Mel and Jack have between, you know, control and his being a little irresponsible but and her being too controlling. I mean, we live through this all the time, and my wife and I have very different parenting styles like the two of them have, and that generates a lot of conflict too. And also, you know, I really felt like I was very, very grateful when I read the movie. I was very, very grateful to my child because I realized if I hadn't had a son, I wouldn't ever have done this movie. I never would have made it. I would never have seen what it was. And because I did feel very inspired by him, and I really wanted to make a movie where the parenting was sort of represented kind of very truthfully and very specifically and very carefully. And I think hopefully we did that, you know. Michelle and George have obviously both contributed tremendously to that, one way and another. George in a way as much through his not having been a parent as being a parent, and Michelle being kind of supermom.
The children... Excuse me, my throat is in bad shape.
Would you like some water?
No, it's okay. The children are just fantastic in this film.
Yeah.
And they're very experienced little actors. But still in all, they are children. So what did you as a director do to try to get the very best performance out of them?
Well, you know, they're both very, very smart, you know, and I trusted that. And I mean, they were both absolutely capable of understanding these situations because they go through them. I mean, one of the most telling things, any screening I was ever at, I talked to 2 8-year-olds after they saw the movie. And what they said was, well, I said, what do you think the movie's about? Well, it's about these 2 kids who are trying to get through their day, and they have these things, they want to get to this soccer game, and their parents do this to them, and their parents do that to them, and their parents put a team to a daycare center instead of taking, they shouldn't do that, they should play with them. So, you know, there was a way of talking about the movie as a movie about the kids, you know, and they then understood it very, very clearly. So, and they're both technically very proficient. I mean, the only trouble I ever had with the kids was the day we shot the scene at Serendipity because they're eating all this ice cream, and I thought, if they start eating all this sugar at 9 a.m, this is going to be over by 11, you know. And so we made these beautiful, like, ice cream confections with no sugar in them, gave them to the kids, and they just turned into, like, prima donnas. They were like, I'm not doing the scene. I can't do it. I can't do it this way. I'm not eating this. I can't do it with this. If there's not sugar in this, we're not doing it. And so finally, I mean, after we were down for about an hour trying to negotiate with the kids, I just said, well, you know, so bring on the sugar. And so... And they just got better and better, you know, and bigger and bigger. And they became like Carol Channing and Jim Carrey by the end of the afternoon. They were just huge and worked out fine.
Was George ever kind of at sea with the kids?
I think he gets frustrated with the kids. I don't know. He's very playful, and the kids loved him for that. So, but I mean, Michelle and I have a total of $11,000 in bets with George and have a child by the time he's 40. And he informed us yesterday that instead he decided that he'd have a vasectomy and pocket the other $6,000. You know, he said he figured he could do that for $5,000. He's not a lover of kids and animals. I mean, you notice when he's with that kitten and he's always sort of petting its head, I always sort of see this slight twisting motion, like he'd be just as happy to be doing some damage. May, who loved the kitten, was like always rushing up to grab it from George between takes to protect it.
I felt, though, that May just really loved George. I mean, I think she does love him
did.
In real life.
She does love him. Last night we had the cast and crew screening, and George went along, which is like, you know, testament to the kind of guy he is. He's just such a, you know, he's such a good man. He's a great guy. And I saw May's parents. I said, where's May? Oh, she's on George's lap. You know, there they were down, you know, the fourth row playing again.
Well,
she loves him.
Again, it's just a delightful film. It should do very well for all of you.
Thanks a lot.
And I look forward to the next time we visit. I don't
Great.
Know what your project
I don't know.
Is.
I don't know yet either. But
I look forward to it.
Okay.
Thank you, Michael.
It's a pleasure. Oh, I'm glad you like
it. Side I'm rolling it now. Yes, please.
And just give me some listener reacts, Bobby.
Oh, I could be talking about something mm-hmm. else that might help you. Yeah. No, I haven't decided yet. I might possibly do something else with Michelle, which we had it was a very happy experience all the way around. You know, if I could just work with these people, the producer, this cast, for the rest of my life, I'd be perfectly content.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.